His earthly pilgrimage came to an end on Thursday, March the 3rd, at the age of 67 years old. Survivors include his wife of 39 years, Angie, a daughter, Jennifer Verner, a son, David Verner, and his wife, Dacia, two brothers, Tommy Verner and his wife, Lynell, James Verner and his wife, Sharon, a sister, Denise Verner Green, and her husband, Larry, and a host of nieces and nephews. The psalmist wrote, "The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. The Lord, the shepherd, are with me. Your rod and your staff comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of this life. And when this life reaches its conclusion, I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Will you pray with me, please? Good Shepherd, as we come to this time and this place today, we want to thank you for Don. Thank you for the time you gave him here and the opportunity each one gathered here had to be touched by him. We surrender him to your care and your presence, and thank you for your assurance that as a good shepherd, you have safely seen Don home. I pray for each of these that are left behind. I pray that you will assure them of your ongoing presence with them, and through your presence that you will strengthen them, encourage them, comfort them, and allow them to experience your peace that passes all understanding while guarding their hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. It's in his name we pray.
The roses aren't as pretty, the sun isn't quite as high, the birds don't sing as sweet of a lullaby. Stars seem a little bit faded, clouds just a little more gray, and it feels like things won't ever be the same. Heaven got another angel tonight, you left this world behind. Heaven got a little better today, took you away from me, missing you. Sweet by the river.
which is synonymous, is entitled to those I love and those who love me. When I am gone, release me. Let me go. I have so many things to see and do. You mustn't tie yourself to me with tears. Be thankful for our beautiful years. I gave you my love, and you can only guess how much you gave to me in happiness. I thank you for the love you each have shown, but now it's time I traveled on alone. So grieve a while for me, if grieve you must, then let your grief be comforted by trust. It's only for a while that we must part, so bless those memories in your heart. I won't be far away, for life goes on, so if you need me, call, and I will come. Though you can't see or touch me, I'm here, with all my love around you, soft and clear. And then, when you must come this way alone, I'll greet you with a smile and say, welcome. Exactly the same set of memories. I want to encourage you as we celebrate Don's life and observe this memorial service today to remember Don the way that you knew him. Think about those special memories that you shared, perhaps with only him. Don loved to work in his vegetable garden. He also enjoyed cooking, and enjoyed cooking for large crowds because that meant family was coming. And then he was something that I didn't even know existed. He was the grand master of online canasta. I just was not aware of that until yesterday. He was proud of his children. He was a good father throughout their lives. He attended sporting events, music events, was always there for them. Importantly, he taught his children about life. What a wonderful heritage that is to leave behind. He loved the big family get-togethers and family reunions and even class reunions. Wherever there was a reunion, Don was going to be there if it was at all possible. Whenever we come to a time like this, we come with grief in our hearts. Grief is a normal human response to any type of loss. One that you've known, one that you've loved, one that you've cared for, one that you've shared your lives with, is no longer physically present. And because of that, we grieve. But I'm glad that as I stand before you today, I can assure you, based on God's word, that because of the cross and the empty tomb, even though we grieve differently now. Paul says we grieve with hope. Biblical hope is not just wishful thinking. It's the absolute certainty that what God has said in his word is true. And one of those things that he tells us is this thing we call death has been swallowed up by life. We grieve today. But if you're grieving for God, you're grieving for the wrong person. He's home. He's there. He's in the presence of the shepherd, fully healed. No more heart problems. No more difficulty to breathe. Even the celestial air, too, which must be a great blessing. He's more fully and consciously alive than he was the very best day he had on this earth. So we don't grieve for him. We grieve for ourselves. And that's proper. That's as it should be. Early in his ministry, Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. They recognize my voice, and they will follow me, but they won't follow this country. One day, Jesus was being criticized by some of the religious folk of his day. They were criticizing him for associating with those that they considered to be sinners. I must admit that I would qualify for that group. Jesus said to them, let me tell you a story. Suppose one of you has 100 sheep. When he gets back to the sheep pen, he counts there are only 99. What will he do? Will he not leave the 99? Go out and search until he finds the lost sheep. And when he finds it, will he not joyfully pick it up, wrap it around his shoulders, and take it? And here we might expect Jesus to say back to the flock or back to the sheep pen, but those are not the words he chose. I'm very grateful he chose the word he did, because Jesus said, the shepherd would take that sheep home. Home. The place that he said he was going to prepare for us. And when these bodies that we use here, which Paul compares to tents on the temporary dwellings, when they finally give out and won't work anymore, we have a building in heaven, a house not made by human hands. What a wonderful promise. The shepherd himself is the one who makes sure that his sheep arrive safely home. In that 23rd Psalm that I cited at the first of the service, David, who was himself a shepherd, quoted all those things about what the shepherd does. And if you'll notice, shepherd totally cares for the sheep. The sheep are totally dependent on the shepherd. Here in the Panhandle, we are pretty familiar with cattle, but we don't know much about sheep. Sheep have absolutely no sense of direction. If they wander off, there's no way they can find their way back unless the shepherd comes and retrieves them. A second thing about sheep is they have no way to defend themselves. No hard outer shell, no sharp teeth or claws. If a wild animal attacks them, they are dead unless the shepherd comes and protects them. And a third thing about sheep, they're top carrying. If they ever fall down and get on their backs, they cannot get back up. And their own weight will crush their lungs and they will smother to death under their own weight unless the shepherd comes and picks them up. See, sometimes we won't feel like we have more to do with it, but it's really all about the shepherd. He's the one who safely sees his sheep. And he has said that if there is one left, he will search, not until he gets tired, not until it gets too late, not until it gets too dark, not until he gets hungry. No, he said that shepherd will search until he finds it. What a wonderful promise that is. He's never lost one yet. I suspect he's not going to start now. That house that Paul talked about, we have after we leave these tents, Jesus referred to that in the upper room with his disciples on the night he would be betrayed. He had told them he was about to die. They were grieving. He said to them, don't let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going to prepare a place for you. And since I'm going to prepare a place for you, I myself will come and receive you, so that where I am, there you may be also. Where I go, you know, and the way you know. Thomas, one of his disciples, said, Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can you know the way? Jesus responded, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. I'd like to go back to that third verse where Jesus said, since I'm going to prepare a place for you, I myself will come and receive you. Unfortunately, that doesn't come through quite so clearly in our English translations, but in the Greek text, it's obvious that Jesus used the emphatic I myself. Why is that so important? Because I know what you've seen on television and in the movies. When the time of death comes, God sends an angel to retrieve us, but Jesus was having none of that. He didn't say he was going to send an angel. He didn't say that he was going to entrust us to an ambassador or an emissary from heaven. No, he said, I myself. The other day, when this tent that Don used while he was here could no longer function in the way it was designed, he slipped out of it. And he heard a voice. And it was a voice he recognized. What Jesus said, I am my sheep. They recognize my voice and they will follow me. It was the voice of the shepherd. Don heard, and the shepherd said, Don, let's go on. He felt strong, loving arms slip underneath him, lift him gently to his breast, and the shepherd carried him home. And there he is today, in God's presence, the Father's house. Really, what has happened is he just beat us to the house. We're all hit. He got there before we did. We can rejoice for him, feel sorry for ourselves, maybe. But he's there, he's home. What a wonderful promise. But the assurance and comfort that we have is that one day each of us will also hear that same shepherd call our names. And we will feel those same loving arms lift us, and he will carry us home to the Father's house. There in his presence throughout eternity, we're told, will be eternal peace and joy. A place where there will be no more sickness, no more pain, no more grieving, no more death, because the former things have passed away. A place where there will be no more departures, no No more goodbyes, no more separations. There in the presence of the shepherd, it will be glorious. I must confess something to you. As glorious as it's going to be in the presence of the shepherd, I'm looking forward to another aspect of that place also. That is reunion with those that I have loved here, who are no longer here because they have buried the shepherd. I'm looking forward to that reunion and being with them and never having to say goodbye to them again. That will indeed be a glorious day. Will you pray with me, please? Father, today we give God back to you. You did not lose him when you gave him to us, and we do not lose him by his return to you. Your Son has taught us that life is eternal and that love cannot die. So this thing we call death is only a horizon, and a horizon is only the limit of our sight. Open our eyes to see more clearly. Draw us closer to you that we might know that we are nearer to our loved ones who are with you. You've told us that you're preparing a place for us. Prepare us also for that place, that where you are, there we may be also always.